We now come to perhaps what's a very important regulation for all of us who are trying to understand this code, study for the exams and clear. That's the IBBI Insolvency Professional Regulation 2016. Under section 196, 207, 208, read with 240. These regulations are made. 240 is the power to make regulations. 196, 207 and 208 are the parts that deal with the IP, for which regulations were needed. Now that we're doing it, we may as well do it thoroughly. Go to 197. It talks about 196, sorry, which is the powers and functions of the board. So what this basically, this regulation does is, if you go through the powers and functions of the board, they talk about registration of IP. It talks about minimum eligibility requirement for IP. It talks about levying fees for an IP. It of course talks about IP, IPA and IU. It talks about regulations for functioning. So it says these are the powers and functions of the board, and it lays down ever so many. It goes up to U. Right? Now, in order to do all this, the board must have the procedural law, right? This is the code. So the procedural law is actually the regulation. Similarly, 206, 207 and 208 are the sections in this act which is chapter 4, part 4, which deal with insolvency professionals. So it says you have to enroll. What is your eligibility for enrollment? It says every professional agency, if you look at 207, says shall, after obtaining the membership of an IPA, register himself with the board under these regulations. Now, so these are the, so essentially why I drew all these references was to just tell you that the regulations actually give power to actually implement the code itself. So definitions, Bar Council means Bar Council under the Advocates Act. Certificate of Registration means Certificate of Registration granted by the board. Code means IBC, CA, CWA, CS. Professional member means a member who is enrolled, an individual member who is enrolled under an IPA. So you become a professional member with an IPA and you're a member, you're enrolled and you get your certificate from the board. Insolvency examinations, chapter 2. The board shall, either on its own or through a designated agency, conduct a national insolvency examination in such manner and frequency as may be specified to test knowledge and practical skills in the areas of insolvency, bankruptcy and other allied subjects. Similarly, it can also conduct a limited insolvency examination. Syllabus shall be published on the website of the board at least 1 month before the examination. If you see now, the syllabus for January onwards, January 2018, has already been published now. Chapter 3, registration of an IP. See, you must remember there are two things. This is just like an auditor. First of all, I need to become a chartered accountant. Then I can become an auditor or of a particular entity for which is seeking to appoint me. Similarly, there are two things here. One is becoming an insolvency professional. Second, being eligible to be a resolution professional in a particular case. That's where all your independence criteria comes. For an entity, can I become an RP? But what we talk about here in IP regulation first is eligibility to be registered as an IP itself. So how do I become a chartered accountant equivalent? I become a chartered accountant by completing my articles training and by writing my CA final exams, right? Similarly here, no individual shall be eligible to be registered as an IP if he is a minor, if he is not resident in India, he does not have the qualification or experience specified in Regulation 5, he has not been convicted by a court of an imprisonment for a term of imprisonment exceeding 6 months or moral turpitude, and a period of 5 years has not elapsed from the date of expiry of that sentence. However, if he has served more than 7 years or more, then he shall not be considered for this registration at all. He is not an undischarged insolvent. He is not declared to be of unsound mind. He is not a fit and proper person. These category of persons can never be registered as an IP. Not pass the exam, moral turpitude, 6 months imprisonment, 5 years elapsed, 7 years, not resident in India, minor, unsound mind, not fit and proper. So in this we spoke, he needs to have the qualification and experience also. That is positive. What he should be, what he should not be. What he should be, qualification and experience. What he should not be is minor, non-resident, the remaining. Now what he should be? National Insolvency Examination. Limited Insolvency Examination plus 15 years experience in management plus bachelor's degree. Okay? So if it is management, it is also a bachelor's degree. Otherwise, it is passing limited insolvency examination and 10 years as a CA, CWA, CS and advocate. Some of us CAs are not graduates, right? But if you have 10 years experience as a chartered accountant, cost accountant, company secretary or an advocate enrolled with the bar, after passing LIE, you can become an insolvency professional. Application for certificate of registration. He can apply for a certificate of registration in Form A along with a non-refundable application fee of 10,000 rupees. Certificate is valid for 5 years and board shall acknowledge within 7 days of receipt. It's the same guideline. He can submit addition. He may need to submit additional documents. He may need to appear in person. If the board is satisfied, then within 60 days it shall grant him the certificate of registration, excluding the time given for rectification of defects. Here it is identical to the other registration processes. Receive application 7 days. 60 days overall time frame. Now,
which year did you want me to check?
If he considers him, if you now move to 8, if after considering an application, the board is of the prima facie opinion that he is not supposed to be given registration, it shall communicate within 45 days and give him 15 days time to respond. Within, after 15 days, within 30 days, the board has to either accept or reject. So you had 7, you had 45, you had 15, you had overall 60 days minus defects, and from 15, you had a 30 days. Okay? Then, the certificate shall be given in Form B. Now, the registration shall be subject to the conditions that he shall abide by the code and bylaws. He shall satisfy the conditions of Regulation 4. Pay a fee of 10,000 rupees once in 5 years. Not render services. If he is not a citizen of India, not a citizen. Eligibility was resident. But here it says he shall not render services as an IP. If he is not a citizen of India, unless he becomes the partner or director of an insolvency professional entity recognized by the board. Okay? Non-resident cannot become an IP. A non-citizen can be an IP if he is a partner or a director in an IPE, which is recognized by the board. Please star that. Take prior permission of the board for shifting his IPA from one to another. It's actually a dual process. First of all, I need to be a professional member with my IPA, and then I also need to be registered with the board. Take adequate steps for redressal of grievances. Maintain records of all assignments. Abide by code of conduct and such other conditions. We already finished 8 by integrating it with 7. Then we go to 9. At the beginning of this act, there was a period for a limited period. He can be enrolled for a limited period if he has been in practice for 15 years as a CA, CWA, CS or advocate and submits an application in Form A along with 5,000 rupees. This is on or before 31st December 2016 only. And it was valid up to June 30th from the date of his registration up to whatever time. So if I had come in, let's say, if I had got my certificate on January 7th, I can go up to July 7th. It's valid only for a period of 6 months. Please star it. IP shall not take any assignment after his registration. But if any assignment is pending, he can complete that assignment. Then we go to chapter 4, which is temporary surrender. He will communicate his temporary surrender. Within 7 days, they have to, the IP, A, shall inform the board of any temporary surrender. Not later than 7 days from the approval of temporary surrender. Then we come to disciplinary proceedings. Based on the findings of an inspection or investigation. If you remember, there was inspection, there was investigation, right? Then there was a disciplinary proceeding by the board. See, because the inspection or investigation is done by the board, so the board's disciplinary mechanism takes over here. The board shall issue a show cause notice, and then they will actually complete the investigation within a period of 6 months. All this part is identical. Okay, in this regulation we are talking about the board handling the disciplinary proceeding of an IP. The actions could be no action, warning, 220, 234, 5. Right? The order passed under sub-regulation 7 shall not become effective until 30 days has elapsed from the date of issuance of the order. And that's about it on this part. Chapter 5. This is the last chapter. And this is on the recognition of an IPE. An LLP, a registered partnership firm. Please star that. Registered partnership firm or a company may be recognized as an IPE if majority of the partners are IPs